Our Lady, the youngest offspring of Sir Thomas Lucas and Elizabeth Layton, grew up in a family staunchly loyal to the crown, with her three brothers being proprietors of St. John's Abbey Manor in Colchester. As a teenager, she joined Queen Henrietta Maria's court and followed her into French exile, spending time at King Louis XIV's court. In 1645, she married William Cavendish, the first Duke of Newcastle upon Tyne, a royalist commander who chose exile in France during the First English Civil War, and she remained overseas with him until the Stuart Restoration in 1660. Upon her return, her story began to take off, producing over 12 original literary works. She leveraged her high social status not merely for prestige, but as a platform to propel her ideas into the salons and intellectual circles of her time. Her position in society granted her unprecedented access to some of the most formidable and revolutionary minds of the 17th century. Her interactions with leading thinkers and philosophers of her era were not merely social calls, they were exchanges of ideas, debates, and discussions that shaped her worldview and left an indelible mark on her writings. So join me now as we look back at the prolific work and life of Margaret Cavendish. Margaret Cavendish, a trailblazing poet, philosopher, essayist, and playwright, was a rarity in her time, publishing works under her name when most female writers remained anonymous. Her writing spanned a diverse range of topics, including gender dynamics, power structures, social etiquette, scientific methodology, and philosophical discourse. Her visionary work, The Blazing World, is a pioneering venture into science fiction. Cavendish's extensive publications in natural philosophy and early modern science were remarkable, totaling over a dozen original works, with revised editions pushing the count to 21. She was known for engraving her portraits on her works' covers, a declaration of sole authorship and creative independence. Both celebrated and critiqued, Cavendish was an unconventional voice in her era. She challenged dominant and mechanical philosophies, advocating for a vitalist approach. In a groundbreaking event in May 1667, she distinguished herself as the first woman to participate in a Royal Society of London meeting, where she interactively dialogued with esteemed members and thinkers like Robert Boyle. Her publications not only earned her fame but also contested the prevailing belief in women's intellectual inferiority. Cavendish championed women's education, arguing for their inherent capacity to learn and benefit from it all. And she believed her works would have been even more refined if she had received an education equivalent to that of her brothers. Margaret Cavendish, the youngest of eight siblings, was born into a life of scandal and privilege. Her father, Thomas Lucas, was exiled following a deadly duel but was later pardoned by King James, allowing the family to return to England in 1603. Raised in a close-knit family, Cavendish lacked formal education but was exposed to the riches of libraries and the guidance of tutors, though she admitted the children often regarded these tutors more as a formality than a trustworthy source of learning. From a young age, Cavendish harboured a keen intellect and a passion for writing, yet societal norms discouraged women from such intellectual pursuits. Consequently, she nurtured her talents in the seclusion of her home. Despite her father's absence, Cavendish recounted that her widowed mother strived to maintain a lifestyle for her family that was scarcely diminished from their life with her father. They lived comfortably, indulging in honest pleasures and harmless delights, mainly due to her mother's adept management, without significant male assistance. Margaret Cavendish's journey as a lady-in-waiting began with her mother's blessing, accompanying Queen Henrietta Maria into French exile. Separated from her family for the first time, Cavendish encountered the challenges of navigating court life alone. Accustomed to the comfort of her siblings' presence, she felt self-conscious and timid among strangers, fearing missteps in speech or conduct. Her reticence made others mistakenly perceive her as foolish, a misconception she preferred over being misjudged as wanton or rude. Despite her initial regret over leaving home and longing to depart the court, Cavendish's mother dissuaded her from what would be considered a disgraceful exit. Instead, she supported her daughter with a generous allowance, far surpassing that of a typical courtier. Cavendish remained in her role for two more years, culminating in her marriage to William Cavendish, the then Marquess of Newcastle. Margaret Cavendish cherished the unique bond she shared with her husband, William Cavendish. Her affection for him rooted not in the titles or wealth, but in his intrinsic qualities, merit, justice, gratitude, duty, and fidelity. These virtues she believed were the glue that held people together, even through adversity, a conviction borne out by their steadfast partnership amid political turmoil. Although they remained childless, despite medical intervention, Cavendish found family life in her stepchildren from William's previous marriage. She formed a particular connection with Jane and Elizabeth, who themselves ventured into writing with their comedic play, The Concealed Fancies. Cavendish's literary contributions extended to penning a biography of her husband. In the dedication, she addressed rumours that questioned the authorship of her works, suggesting her husband was the actual writer, while acknowledging their creative collaboration and his role as her writing mentor, she emphasised their mutual support in their public and literary endeavours. A few years into her marriage, Margaret Cavendish and her brother-in-law Sir Charles Cavendish ventured back to England upon hearing rumours of the impending sale of her husband's estate, which had been seized due to his allegiance to the royalist cause. Cavendish hoped to gain some financial benefit from the sale as his wife. However, her aspirations could not be fulfilled as she received no profits from the sale. She observed that while numerous women petitioned for monetary aid, her solitary attempt was rejected, leading her to conclude that such endeavours were futile. In her work, A True Relation of My Birth, Breeding and Life, Cavendish confessed that her innate shyness, termed as melancholia, made her regret her decision to explore the world beyond her home. This reticence extended to her hesitation to publicly discuss her writings, a topic she humorously addressed in her pieces. Cavendish not only identified but also explored remedies for her melancholic symptoms, which she detailed as a chill paleness, a struggle to communicate verbally, and unpredictable movements. Margaret Cavendish's stance on God and religion was enigmatic. While her writings reflect her Christian beliefs, she rarely dwelled on religious topics. In Physical Opinions, she affirmed her faith in God, urging readers not to mistake her for an atheist. However, she endeavoured to disentangle philosophy from theology, often steering clear of discussing divine actions in her philosophical works. Her cautious approach to theology was unconventional, particularly during an era when women's literature was predominantly grounded in religious themes. Although Cavendish recognised the existence of a divine entity, she maintained that natural reason cannot perceive or have an idea of an immaterial being. Thus, she posited that when we speak of God, we attempt to describe a being that is ultimately inexpressible and incomprehensible. Margaret Cavendish was unapologetically individualistic, as reflected in her memoirs, where she expressed delight in fashion as a self-expression. She sought uniqueness not only in her attire, but also in her thoughts and actions, shunning the idea of mimicking other women's styles. Moreover, she did not relinquish her desire for fame, aspiring to surpass others in virtue and longing for enduring renown. Aware of potential censure for penning her memoir, Cavendish was unbothered, contending that her writing was a personal endeavour aimed not at amusement, but at providing posterity with an authentic narrative of her ancestry and existence. She defended her choice by citing precedents set by historical figures like Caesar and Ovid, who chronicled their own lives. Margaret Cavendish passed away in London and was laid to rest in the venerable Westminster Abbey on January the 7th, 1674. In a testament to her significance and his devotion, her husband commissioned a monument by the renowned sculptor Grinling Gibbons, which was placed in the Abbey's north transept. The epitaph on her headstone honours her noble lineage and personal virtues, stating, "Her name was Margaret Lucas, youngest daughter of Lord Lucas, Earl of Colchester. A noble family, for all the brothers were valiant and all the sisters virtuous." This epitaph inspired the title of a novel and subsequent film adaptations in the early 20th century, aptly named All the Brothers Were Valiant. Her marriage to William Cavendish, the Duke of Newcastle, was not just a union of hearts, but of minds. Together, they navigated the tumultuous waters of the English Civil War, shared a passion for intellectual pursuits, and sought refuge in the life of the mind when the world around them seemed to crumble. Margaret's bashfulness, often mistaken for a lack of insight, was a mask for a mind in constant contemplation. She questioned the world around her, seeking to understand the divine and the natural through a lens of curiosity and skepticism. Her contributions to philosophy and science were radical, not just in content, but in their very existence, authored by a woman's hand in a man's world. Her pursuit of fame was unapologetic, a desire to ensure her work and name would endure through the ages. In this, she was successful. Centuries later, Margaret Cavendish is remembered not only for her writings, but for her role in redefining what women could aspire to be. In her own words and works, she crafted a self-portrait of a woman who was as much a product of her time as she was a beacon for the future. Margaret Cavendish, Duchess of Newcastle upon Tyne, remains a figure of inspiration. Her life, a reminder that the pen, wielded with courage and conviction, still can be mightier than the sword.